Think Tech Hawaii. Civil engagement lives here.
Lens of history, history lens. Yes. Here on a given Tuesday with Professor John David Ann of HBU, a history professor. You know, they're all like special gifts to us.
Thanks,
history
Jay.
Professors are special
Jay,
people.
Keep going.
We have
Whoa.
To prize them
Woo!
To take care
All right.
of them.
I love it.
Have you hugged your history professor today?
Oh, that's a great slogan. I'll take that to my class.
How can we understand where we are if we don't know where we've been, really?
Right.
It's a navigational
right.
issue.
Yes,
and for
right.
that matter, how
right.
can we understand where we're going if we don't know where we've been?
Right, right, yeah.
So today's
yeah.
a special show, John, because today we're yeah. going to parse out forward and backward, the Gettysburg Address,
right.
which is a pivotal document in so many ways.
That's right.
Tell us
That's
about
right.
it.
Well, so, you know, when we were talking last time about American exceptionalism, and I thought, you know, one of the things we didn't discuss was whether or not American exceptionalism is actually true. You know, I described it as this kind of mythology. And what I would say is that American exceptionalism is true once in a while. That there are moments in American history and in American life where the United States has been exceptional. And I think that's probably the best way to think about it. And one of those moments was the Gettysburg Address. Because, of course, the Gettysburg Address was Lincoln's reframing of the purpose of the war. A war that to that point had been about saving the Union, and now the war became about freeing the slaves. So in that moment, in the moment of the address itself, he was beginning to convince the American people that there was this new birth of freedom. And so if we can bring up the Gettysburg Address and we can look a little closer at it, it's really a great document. It's a brilliant document. So there it is. And 4 score and 7 years ago, of course, this is 87 years ago, which was, you know, 17.
Score is 20.
That's right.
Everybody knows that. Yeah.
1776. So, new nation conceived in liberty. So Lincoln is talking about the Civil War, the testing of the Civil War. He's talking now. He's talking about the field, the Battle of Gettysburg, and so the Battle of Gettysburg. Of course, what the reason why Lincoln is there is because he has to consecrate this new memorial. There's so many battle dead from the Battle of Gettysburg that the town and the people, they have to get these bodies underground. Otherwise, they will fester and they'll cause disease and the rest of it. And so so Lincoln is there. He's
it was a national cemetery.
That it becomes a national.
It was the first national cemetery.
That's correct. It becomes a national cemetery. And some of the other language, if you could bring that address back up, some of the language of the Gettysburg Address is, so if you see the first line of the third paragraph, in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. Those are religious words, and Lincoln is dipping into American exceptionalism with those words, what we sometimes refer to as American civil religion, this idea that the United States has a sacred mission. And so the address is a kind of classic statement of that. And so, and Lincoln refers to the mission so nobly advanced, the honored dead, which is, of course, the war dead. And he's arguing that actually the reason to free the slaves, or the justification, the atonement for the sin of slavery is the war dead. It's the sacrifice of the soldiers on the field, which really resonates with the Civil War anyhow, because the Civil War really was about the battles. It was about the sacrifice of the men that really made the difference. It wasn't about the politics so much, but it was really the Civil War and the changes that the Civil War brought. That was done on the battlefield. And so Lincoln recognized that in the Gettysburg Address. It's part of what makes it such an important address. So the other thing about the address that's interesting, right? It says Lincoln scribbled this address in his hotel room. Well, he had been working on it. He worked on it on the train into Gettysburg.
On the train, I recall that.
Yes, the night before. And then he worked on it the next morning. But it is remarkable for its concision. It's unbelievable, really. I mean, it's a 2-minute speech. And the person before him, Everett Edwards, had gotten up and spoken for 2 hours. And this that was much more typical of oratory of the 19th century was to, you know, get up and talk and make allusions to, you know, the classical battles and wars and everything. And so Lincoln just got him and said, look, here it is. This is what our forefathers sacrificed for. This is what the men on the battlefield sacrificed for. And it's a new birth of freedom. And that's how he ends the address.
It's brilliant.
It's a brilliant address.
Because he knew that they would read it far and wide. He knew that it would be a pivotal point. It would be an expression of the United States as it was emerging from this war.
Right.
And he wrote it with the experience and the sensibilities of somebody who knew about public relations.
Yeah.
And who knew about the English language.
Exactly.
And knew about speech making.
Exactly. And Gary Wills wrote a book on the Gettysburg Address.
Really?
And Wills talks about the classical structure of the speech, where Lincoln took some from Greek and Roman oratory and actually used some of that structure in the speech. It's a fascinating book. Lincoln is really reframing the purpose of the nation at this point.
Yeah.
I think it's maybe the greatest speech in the history of the nation.
Yes, and if you look at the text, you know, the copy of it, it's poetry. I mean, the best speeches are, in my view, they're poetry.
Yeah.
There isn't a single word there that doesn't have some charge to it.
Right.
There are no wasted words, no extra words. It's boiled right down to the essential poetry of what he wanted to say.
Exactly.
What a guy.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
So this must have been distributed all over the country, this speech.
Yeah, yeah. It was published in all of the newspapers. And so the speech and the ideas of the speech got out pretty quickly. I think, you know, it as I said, I think it ranks as maybe the best speech in American history. I would say Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech is right up there. And another, I think, maybe another exceptional moment in the history of the country, because, of course, after that, you get civil rights legislation and real movement on the issue of, you know, racial equality. So Lincoln makes the speech. He has done the Emancipation Proclamation earlier, you know, January 1st, 1863. And so Lincoln's intent with this new birth of freedom is moving towards freeing the slaves and making the war about freedom. Lincoln's ability to envision a future for the country is so important. His ability to kind of project forward what the country will look like.
Big question. I mean, did the war make him more involved in that issue? More did it create a greater passion for him, or was he like that before the war? And this, you know, was just a view that he held, but it was enhanced by the war. I mean, how did that continuum go?
Yeah, well, Lincoln, of course, he's very concerned about the contradiction that slavery represents, and he expresses this as early as 1838 when he gives a speech in spring at the Springfield Lyceum. He gives a speech there. He talks about the tensions that are ongoing over the issue of slavery, you know, conflicts between abolitionists and pro-slavery people even then. So, yeah, I mean, this is something he's been thinking about for a long time. But for Lincoln, the real genius of Lincoln is that he has moved. He moves from a position of not touching slavery in the South at the beginning of the war to, by 1864, believing that slavery must be abolished as part of the purpose of the war.
Yeah, and I wanted to ask you about the connection, if there is a connection, and he must have been aware of it, of the race riots in New York
in July
of 1863, just a few months before.
Right, right.
And, I mean, that was a very clear expression that the Union was not without racial prejudice
That's
and
exactly
bigotry
right.
and hatred. Yeah. What happened is, as I recall, that it was a draft. They announced a draft in July of 1863.
That's correct, yes.
And you could get out of the draft for $300 American, which is a lot of time, a lot of money at that time. and people resented that.
Yeah.
So, you know, the poor Irish in New York and whoever else was poor in New York at the time rose up and had a riot about the draft.
That's right.
But the streets were dissembling.
Yeah.
And everybody was, you know, on the streets, and then there was noise and commotion and riot, and all of a sudden, this became a race riot.
Yeah.
It transmuted itself into a race riot.
Yeah.
And it was bloody lethal. And it was against the blacks who lived in New York at the time.
Yeah.
And the rioters were hanging them.
Yeah.
Oh, I remember, it was a Saturday night. Remember this part, John? It was a Saturday night.
Everybody
was in a bar drinking. They used to do that pretty heavily in New York. And they all got wired up in the bar, and they came out of the bar, and they looked for somebody to hang.
Yeah,
and they started hanging blacks from the lampposts all up and down Manhattan.
Right.
And this was really a problem, and it took the military.
Right.
Lincoln brought the military back to New York.
He called in the army.
It took him several days to quell it.
Yeah.
So, you know, so he knew about it, obviously. So the question is, you know, did this have an effect on his thinking about race and about, you know, emancipation of the slaves? And did it affect his thinking as he expressed it in Gettysburg?
Yeah, I suppose, honestly, we don't have good information on that, actually. So it's really kind of an open question. Lincoln didn't write down in his diary anything about this, you know, the uprising in New York City, the race riot that took place in July 1863. So we don't really know, but one could assume, since he clearly knew about it, I mean, he was the one who sent in troops to quell the riot. Since he knew about it, then we can assume that it confirmed his understanding of some parts of America that were still very racist, very, you know, anti-black. And it's, you know, maybe no surprise, because most Americans were still quite racist in this time period.
Including in the Union.
That's correct. Abolitionism was still a minority game. And that's why the speech is so important, because Lincoln actually is changing people's minds. He's pulling the electorate along with him towards a position of abolishing slavery and anti-slavery and a less, I'd say, a less racist position. I say less racist because, of course, racism doesn't go away. It's very much a part of the fabric of the United States in the post-Civil War period. So,
Well, that was very interesting to think that. Maybe, so I'm speculating, I don't know if you'll agree with me, that, you know, part of the reason for the pivot in the Gettysburg Address, the expression of what he was saying, the high, noble ideal he was expressing, is, you know, I just saw what happened in New York.
Oh.
That wasn't so good.
Yeah.
I'd better say something and do something to you know, make people realize that they shouldn't do that.
Yeah. No, I don't think so, because the thing about Lincoln is he did issue the Emancipation Proclamation. He's thought long and hard about the issue of slaves in the context of the war. I mean, before the Emancipation Proclamation, he's having to think about the slaves, because what do you do with the slaves once you conquer territory? Should those slaves be freed? Should they be taken by the Union? Should they be handed back to their masters? So Lincoln has thought long and hard about this before July 1863. Mm-hmm. So this is really part of a larger whole for Lincoln.
Yes.
He's really, but he makes an explicit decision to extend the Emancipation Proclamation into an effort to free all slaves, this new birth of freedom that he talks about in the Gettysburg Address.
And it shows you that one piece of paper, which we were looking at a minute ago,
that's right,
can have such huge historical moments.
Exactly. And one person's ideas, you know, with the talent, the skill base, the vision to see what a new America could look like, Abraham Lincoln did this. He reshaped our country, and he pulled the American people along. And he was pushed too, it should be said. He was pushed by abolitionists into this position. So,
it's profound. Thing is profound, and I think we're going to take exactly 1 minute and let it sink in.
Okay.
And let it sink in right now.
Okay. Ooh.
Hello, I'm Cynthia Lee Sinclair, and I have a show called Finding Respect in the Chaos. It's all about women's rights and gender equality. It's a place for survivors of abuse to come on and tell their stories, and a place for advocates to come on and share important resources so that people can get past the abuse and into the hope and healing that's on the other side. I hope you'll join me every other Friday at 3 o'clock for Finding Respect in the Chaos. I'm Cynthia Lee Sinclair on ThinkTechHawaii.com.
Hey, baby, that's you. I want to know, will you watch my show? I hope you do. It's on Tuesdays at 1 o'clock, and it's Out of the Comfort Zone, and I'll be your host, R.B. Kelly. See you there.
Okay, we've been discussing the Gettysburg Address with John David Ann of HBU, our favorite history professor, for whom we put a little bumper sticker on, says, have you hugged your history professor today? Anyway, so we've been sinking it in.
Yes, right.
About the Gettysburg Address.
Yes, yeah, right.
And here we are. It's been said, it's been distributed, it's been in the newspapers.
Right.
Did the whole country rally around, or was there still some controversy?
This is actually the problem of 1864, the year after the Gettysburg Address, is that not everybody agreed with this. In fact, there was entrenched opposition, especially among Democrats, to Lincoln's vision of a new birth of freedom. And Democrats wanted to end the war. Now, what happens is, in early 1864, Ulysses S. Grant takes over the Army of the Potomac in the East, and he decides he's going to fight, and it doesn't matter how many casualties he takes, he's going to fight and fight, and he does, and he takes enormous casualties. So many that the public begins to turn against the war, the public in the North. And this is also a re-election year. So Lincoln is up for re-election.
Big problem for him.
That's right. And General McClellan is running against him. And
the guy who was a do-nothing general early
that's
on.
Right, that's right. And so so Lincoln is, he's concerned. He gets quite nervous, actually, is quite open about his misgivings. He writes at one point, I think I need to plan for maybe losing this election. And so it's interesting, the commentators respond to Lincoln's misgivings. And one guy named Lewis Maurer, he actually creates a political cartoon about Lincoln's misgivings about this election. If we can bring up that cartoon, it's a bizarre and almost frightening cartoon. So Lincoln was very open about his belief that his dreams were prophetic, that when he dreamed something, it's possible that it would become reality in the future. And so Maurer took this idea and then he extended it into a political cartoon. And so you see Lincoln is sleeping, he's dreaming, and this is Lincoln's nightmare going into the election of 1864, is that first of all, General McClellan is climbing the steps into the White House. You can see him there. And then next to McClellan is Lady Liberty, who is holding the severed head of an African-American, presumably an African-American slave. Lincoln is off to the our left, or your right, running away from the White House, and he's saying, this ain't no joke to me, paraphrased. And so what does this all mean? Well, this is Lincoln's nightmare scenario, and I think Maurer is probably trying to motivate people to go to the polls and vote, because this is truly a nightmare to have McClellan walking into the White House, to have the African-American attacked and maybe even beheaded, his rights taken away, his maybe future freedom taken away. So
reversing what Lincoln had gained.
Exactly, reversing the Gettysburg Address in many ways. So it's a fascinating political cartoon, and we'll come back to this issue of Lincoln's dreams because it's quite important.
Yes, yes, he had other dreams too.
That's correct. Yeah. So 1864 is this, it's a year in which it looks like the war could be lost and all of the gains therein lost. Lincoln is maybe having nightmares. Certainly, political cartoonists are putting nightmares in Lincoln's heads, in his head. But what happens then is that his generals bail him out. So if we can put up the battle map, and this is the Battle of William T. Sherman's Army, which is in Tennessee. You can see in May 1864, Sherman's Army is in Chattanooga and wins a battle there, and then begins to march south towards Atlanta in the summer of 1864, and reaches Atlanta in September 1864. Now, this is a huge army. It's over 60,000 men, And the Confederates do not have an army that can touch this army. You can see they have armies that follow. Johnston is following Sherman's army but cannot attack Sherman's army because it's just too large. Johnston has less than half of that number of troops. So he can do nothing but harass Sherman. Sherman then lays siege to Atlanta, and the commander in Atlanta, Hood, withdraws from Atlanta. And so Sherman captures Atlanta, I think, on about September 8th, and then burns Atlanta to the ground. But the capture of Atlanta in the deep South, in the heart of the South, Atlanta was a kind of a railroad capital. There were, I think, eight different railroad lines that came into Atlanta. So a major distribution center for the South.
Economic center, for sure.
It was very important to the South. And so now that Sherman's got it, Hood himself actually burns down, starts the fire that burns down Atlanta, and then Sherman just continues it. Sherman takes his crew, his army takes, pulls up railroad ties, because you do this to prevent Southern trains from running. And because the Confederates had gotten good at putting the ties back when they came, you know, when they came back in, then he takes these railroad ties, his troops do, they heat them up in a fire and they twist them around trees. They're called Sherman neckties. So that they cannot be used again. Yeah, so can we, if we can bring that slide back up.
Devastation trail, yeah.
So then Sherman decides, what do I do next? And he decides upon a march to the sea. And so from Atlanta to Savannah in the month of December, it's called Sherman's March to the Sea. He marches his army about 60 miles wide. They cut a swath. They destroy everything in sight. They do not kill civilians. So generally speaking, there are no atrocities, but there's lots of burning. Lots of destruction of property and such.
Including private residences and farms.
Exactly.
And
big estates, plantations. The message is clear. The Northern armies can march through the center of the South unimpeded, and they can destroy at will.
Demoralizing the South in one fell swoop.
It was the greatest hit to Southern morale of the war. And then you can see later on then Sherman in the next year, in early 1865, he marches in through South Carolina, does the same thing, trying to punish those who first started secession, the South Carolinians, and then, of course, marches through North Carolina.
The same devastation.
Yes, that's right, wreaking devastation and showing the South that they have no choice now. So the capture of Atlanta wins Lincoln his reelection.
Ah,
yes.
Interesting. But at the same time, though, I recall right in that period, there were signs by, you mentioned this, there were signs by various groups in the North where they were really tired of war.
No, that's right. That's
tired
right.
of losing that's
right.
their sons.
Right.
Tired of the money, the taxes, yeah. whatever. And they wanted to stop, put a lot of pressure on Lincoln about that.
That's correct. One of the things Lincoln did was he released soldiers in his armies, to go vote. He released them from duty because they were quite supportive of Lincoln. They understood the cost of war and the prize of war and had bought in fairly early to this idea that the war should be a war to end slavery. And so at least a good majority of his soldiers. And they voted disproportionately for Lincoln, helped Lincoln to win re-election. And of course, then Lincoln is re-elected. The South is under great duress. The South loses its army almost completely in early 1865. You have desertion rates that are up over 50%. And so the North is going to win this war. It's very clear by early 1865 that the North is going to win. And then in April is the month in 1865 that we have to talk about, because on April 5th, 1865, the Union enters Richmond. Jefferson Davis and his government flee Richmond. They essentially are giving up Richmond to the Union Army. And Lincoln tours Richmond with his son. To see Lincoln walking through Richmond with his troops, I mean, it's inspiring to residents supportive of the Union. African Americans in Richmond come out in droves, and they celebrate what they see as the liberation of Richmond. And then, of course, uh, uh, then
Were there any negotiations here? I recall in the Spielberg movie Lincoln, at some point, I can't say when, there were attempts, and Lincoln had to wrestle with this, to negotiate a settlement rather than a surrender.
That's correct.
When was that happening?
This is happening between February and April 1865. So Lincoln has agreed to meet. There are peace commissioners from the South who want to settle the conflict.
And they made the gesture.
And Lincoln has agreed to meet. Lincoln wants to show himself as being magnanimous, so he agrees to meet with them, but then they have to set a date. And Lincoln keeps putting off the date and putting off the date and putting off the date.
He's playing both ends.
That's right. So the peace commissioners sit and wait aboard this steamer. I think it's at Hampton Roads, Virginia. They sit and wait, and they wait, and they wait, and the Union Army racks up victory after victory, and then eventually it becomes irrelevant.
There's no need to have a settlement when you've got it all.
You're winning the war at this point. So then on April 9th, Ulysses S. Grant and the Army of the Potomac catches up with Lee's army, the Army of Northern Virginia, and Lee, like a gentleman, understands that for him the war is over.
Yeah.
He surrenders, and his troops surrender. And you know, it's an important moment because there could have been a bloodbath. The Union Army could have really taken it out on the Confederate troops. They could have treated them very badly, but they didn't. They allowed Confederates to keep their firearms because they knew they needed to go home and
hunt.
That's correct, and protect their families. So it's an important moment, I think, in our history that shows after this horrific war where men are killing one another, that men could also, these same men could come together.
That was Lincoln.
Yeah.
Lincoln made that happen.
Well,
I would not have gone down that way if he hadn't approved it.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm not 100% sure that that's just Lincoln. I think it's also those who believed that the war had created this terrible chasm that had to end, right?
They were tired of war.
That's right. Yeah. So I think that's a part of it. And then, of course, Lincoln goes back to Washington, D.C., and he's beginning to prepare for Reconstruction. He even considers now that the black man, black officers, should have the right to vote. And this is quite something because, of course, 5 years earlier, they were all slaves in the South. And so Lincoln is preparing for this, and then he wants a break. He wants to take an evening off. He's exhausted, but he thinks a play, a musical maybe at Ford's Theater would be good recreation for him. And so Lincoln and his wife, Mary Todd, go to Ford's Theater, and this is when he's assassinated. And of course, we know the story well. Lincoln is, he's in his booth with Mary Todd Lincoln, and the soldier who's supposed to be guarding him is at a tavern next door with Lincoln's driver and his, you know, his carriage driver. Yeah, so John Wilkes Booth enters the president's box, shoots him, and then jumps down onto the stage and hollers, you know, death to tyrants, and limps off because he is probably, we think he broke his leg during this. So
when he jumped.
Yeah, yeah, that's correct. So this is really, but what's really interesting about this is 10 days earlier, Lincoln had another dream. Lincoln had all of these dreams. And Lincoln had a dream in which he was in the White House and he was confused. And so it sounded like there was gnashing of teeth and cries of grief. And so he walks downstairs in the White House and he sees a casket laid out before him, and there's a soldier next to the casket, and he asked the soldier, who is this? Who has died? And he said, the president, sir. He's been assassinated.
Wow.
Yeah, yeah. So Lincoln's, in this case, unfortunately, Lincoln's dream came true.
Yeah.
And, you know, very powerful dream.
Yeah, it's interesting that, it reveals, I mean, aside from the fact that it was a dream, it reveals that he knew there were people out there that didn't like him that would organize an assassination.
And he said to his armed guard, look, I'll probably be killed someday, but don't let them get away with it. That's kind of a paraphrase, but essentially that's what he was saying. Punish the buggers if they kill me. So, and we can see in back of us here is Lincoln on his deathbed with his cabinet gathered around, his doctors, and there he is. And the bed's too short. That's why he's all propped up like that. The bed was too short for his frame. And the next morning then he breathed his last. This is a very positive portrait that was created later in 1865. And of course, the nation went into mourning. His body was taken from Washington, D.C., and then on a train.
All around.
Went through New York.
In the South, too?
I don't think so.
Yeah.
Went up through New York City and then eventually to Springfield, Illinois, where his body, that's where his body lays in state today. So.
Yeah, and the nation, at least the North, was in mourning for quite some time over that. What's remarkable, one of the things, so many remarkable things here, John, is that the world had changed. Lincoln had been instrumental in changing it.
Right, that's right.
In between 1861 and 1865, 4 years, one term, not even quite one term.
That's right.
And what it shows you is that one term as president, even in those days when things moved a lot slower than they do now, one president in one term can change the world as we know it.
That's true.
It's even more possible now.
Okay.
People think, oh, we can wait out this administration. You know, we just wait it out, it'll go away. No, in 4 years, you can do miracles.
You had to bring that up.
Sorry. Same political party.
Yes, right, that's right.
So this is one of the great heroes of American history, one of the great heroes of world history, really. And going back to your point about exceptionalism, I think up until 1861, you know, if you look for exceptionalism, it's a mixed bag in this country.
That's true.
And as you said, I mean, all through our history, it's a mixed bag, and some people will think this is exceptional, and that's not. But, you know, in this period of time, with the moral positions he was taking, the things he was doing, the kind of analysis and presence that he put on things, it was exceptional.
Yeah.
In that special period of time.
No, that's right. I mean, he elevated the nation and was a truly great president.
Well, thank you, John. Been great to talk to you, as always, and great to learn about this stuff. And great to feel, you know, that there's some real historic resilience in the country.
Yes, there's hope.
There's hope.
Yes.
We have to look back a little bit to find it.
Absolutely, yes.
Good. Thank you, John.
You bet.
We'll do this again.
Sure.